Good morning. The parallel axis theorem is a convenient way to determine the moment of inertia or rotational inertia of a rigid body about an axis which is parallel to an axis which runs through the center of mass of the object. The parallel axis theorem states that the rotational inertia about any axis parallel to and a distance capital D away from the axis which passes through the center of mass of the object equals the rotational inertia about the center of mass of the object plus capital M, the total mass of the object, multiplied by the square of capital D, which is defined as the linear distance between the two parallel axes.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds way more complicated than it actually is. I'm sorry about that. In order to prove the parallel axis theorem, let's begin with a rigid object with shape and determine its rotational inertia about an axis which is perpendicular to the screen and passes through point P, a point which is not at its center of mass. Again, the center of mass of the rigid body is labeled capital CM, and we are going to rotate the object around an axis which is perpendicular to the screen and passes through point capital P.
That is a weird shape for an object. Does the shape of the object matter?
Green?
No, Bo, that is the whole point of picking a random shape. The shape of the object does not matter. Now, let's place the origin of our coordinate system at the center of mass of the object. Identify an infinitesimally small piece of the object, dm, which is located a variable distance in the x direction, x, and a variable distance in the y direction, y. Again, both of those distances are in the x or y direction from the origin, which is also the center of mass to the location of dm. Point P, the location of the axis about which we are determining the rotational inertia of this object, is located a fixed distance in the x direction, x sub p, and a fixed distance in the y direction, y sub p. Again, because dm is a representative piece of this rigid body, its location could be anywhere on the object, and therefore x and y are variables. However, point p is a fixed location on the rigid body, and x sub p and y sub p are fixed distances. All right, now that we have the setup, Bobby, what is the general equation for the moment of inertia of a rigid body?
Flippin' physics.
The rotational inertia of a rigid body equals the integral with respect to mass of the square of r, the distance from the axis of rotation to each infinitesimally small piece of the rigid body, dm.
And nice!
Thanks.
Again? Really?
Now, technically, because r is defined as the distance from the origin to dm, or the distance from the center of mass to dm, the equation you just gave me is for the rotational inertia about the center of mass of the rigid body. If we define a as the distance from dm to point p, then we replace the variable distance r with the variable distance a. We get the rotational inertia of the rigid body about the axis which goes through point P and is parallel to the axis which goes through the center of mass, which is what we are trying to find here.
Why the letter A?
There are a lot of letters here, and A has not been used yet.
Okay.
Now, A has components in the x direction and in the y direction such that, according to the Pythagorean theorem, a squared equals a in the x direction squared plus a in the y direction squared. Billy, please solve for a in the x direction and a in the y direction in terms of x, x sub p, y, and y sub p.
Solve for a in the x direction and a in the y direction in terms of x, x sub p, y, and y sub p? How do I do that?
If you look at the x direction, the distance x sub p is the same as the distance x plus the distance a in the x direction.
Okay, so a in the x direction equals x sub p minus x, and in the y direction, y equals y sub p plus a in the y direction, which means a in the y direction equals y minus y sub p, but how does that help us?
Yeah, it's going to take a bit to show how that helps us out. You just need to trust me that it does.
Okay.
Sure.
Now we can substitute those values into the Pythagorean theorem, and then substitute that value back into the rotational inertia equation in the place of a squared. Now, Bo, please FOIL those binomials and organize the terms in a logical order.
Sure. X sub p minus x quantity squared equals x sub p squared minus 2x sub p times x plus x squared. Y minus y sub p quantity squared equals y squared minus 2y sub p times y plus y sub p squared. And we can rearrange the terms to put like terms together. Let's put x sub p squared with y sub p squared and x squared and y squared together.
Thank you, Bo. Now let's organize this equation into separate integrals so we can evaluate the integrals more easily. Bobby, identify which of these letters are constants and therefore can be taken out from under their integrals.
X sub p and y sub p are constants, so they can be taken out from under the integral. However, x and y are variables, so they cannot be taken out from under the integral.
Exactly. Now, remember that the x and y centers of mass of our object are located at the origin. Therefore, both the x and y centers of mass of the object equal zero. And the equations for each of those are the position of the center of mass equals the inverse of the total mass of the object times the integral of position with respect to mass. How does that help with regards to our current equation for the rotational inertia of the rigid body about the axis which goes through point P and is perpendicular to the screen?
Both position centers of mass equals zero. How does that help?
That means the integral of position with respect to mass equals zero.
Okay.
Therefore, both of the middle terms in our equation equal zero.
Oh.
All right. We are doing well. Let's look at just the first term. The quantity x sub p squared plus y sub p squared all times the integral with respect to mass. Thoughts?
X sub p squared plus y sub p squared equals the square of the distance from the center of mass to point P.
Oh, that distance is capital D. We defined that earlier. Capital D is the distance between the center of mass and point P, the location of the new axis of rotation. That is capital D in the parallel axis theorem.
And the integral with respect to mass is just the mass of the whole object, or capital M.
So we have capital M times capital D squared. That is one of the terms in the parallel axis theorem.
Correct. Now let's look at just the second term. The integral of the quantity x squared plus y squared with respect to mass. What does that equal?
X squared plus y squared equals r squared, where r is the variable distance from the center of mass to dm. That is the moment of inertia about the axis which passes through the center of mass of the rigid body. We now have the whole parallel axis theorem. We derived the parallel axis theorem.
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
Again, the parallel axis theorem is a convenient way to determine the moment of inertia or rotational inertia of a rigid body about an axis which is parallel to an axis which runs through the center of mass of the object. The parallel axis theorem states that the rotational inertia about any axis parallel to and a distance capital D away from the axis which passes through the center of mass of the object equals the rotational inertia about the center of mass of the object plus capital M, the total mass of the object, multiplied by the square of capital D, which is defined as the linear distance between the two parallel axes. Hopefully that makes a lot more sense now.
Yep.
It does.
Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.